Okay, we are going to skip to item 3.6. I'm going to ask Matt to come up here. The board will recall that, you know, we talked both last year and this year about providing more opportunity for, you know, those outside our system to present new ideas, new things, be it in the political realm, technology realm, academic realm, whatever it is. And I read an article, I'm going to say it's 5 months ago now, something like that, about a company called Inkling.com who had kind of revolutionized the way content is presented and delivered. And I was so taken with the article that I actually flew up to San Francisco to meet with the president of the company. And I was so taken with what they were doing that I said, here is one of the answers to engagement of students. And so I wanted to invite Matt to come up just for a short time to share it with you all and the colleges that are listening and watching today. I think it's part of our role as the Board of Governors, again, to present new ideas and new things and to provide options. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to Matt McGinnis, who's the president of Inkling.com.
Thanks, President Himmelstein. Thank you all for hearing me out. I'll keep it a fun 20 minutes, I promise. Mm-hmm. Bippity-boppity. It's fun coming in from a startup where, as a team that just 2 years ago was me on my sofa and today is a little over 80 people in downtown San Francisco, to come into a very different environment. We fly by the seat of our pants a little more than I think you guys do, although perhaps that's not true. Inkling, just by way of introduction, is a publishing platform for iPad today, although we are not going to be constrained to iPad forever. And I want to tell you a bit of a personal story about what got me to do what I'm doing for a living today, firmly rooted in the world of education and some of the frustrations I experienced through my time as a student and then in my career at Apple. Inkling is reinventing the textbook. We're looking far, far beyond what the print book can do and looking for solutions from a technology perspective that can not only lower costs for students, but also open new doors and, from our perspective, really level the playing field from a socioeconomic perspective and from a learning capacity perspective. The book favors a very particular kind of learner, and there's a whole new world of opportunity with respect to these technologies for people who don't necessarily learn well by reading abstract text. It's a whole world of folks, and some of those people are in California's community college system. Now, I said that this was sort of a personal story. For me, everything is a story. At least in hindsight, it's very easy to weave one, but I think this one's pretty accurate. I sat on a school bus at the age of 8 years old. I'm Canadian, so I was in a very rural community in northeastern Canada. Lots of snow, lots of igloos, lots of moose. And we were on the bus, and I was sitting next to a friend named Nick, and Nick was also 8, and we had just been given our spellers, the little books that are sized for hands the size of an 8-year-old, to learn how to spell words. And I remember very distinctly turning to Nick and saying, hey, we're big kids now, because we had finally been given our first textbooks. And the grin on his face, you know, long end of the stick, maybe. I went through school. I was very well versed in learning from books. I learned how to learn from books, and I got to go to Harvard and get a world-class education and come out and go work for Apple. And when I worked for Apple, I sat in the back of a lot of classrooms, both K-12 and higher education, where I saw the misuse of technology to a level that kind of blew my mind. We would work with rich schools, poor schools, big schools, little schools to deploy thousands of laptops into the hands of students. This was before there was an iPad. And we would spend $1,200 a head to get this device in front of the students, and then the teacher would say, turn to page 376. And it broke my heart because there was so much potential in that technology, but it wasn't being used because there was no obvious way to compete with the familiar. to compete with the familiarity of the textbook that's been in our educational system for so long, and with good reason. The book is a very, very powerful device. Arguably, the book is the single most powerful information technology device humanity has ever known. And it's been so widely distributed that we now build entire institutions around them. We build libraries, concrete buildings in which to house our books. And we design curricula around books. Teachers look at the book, they look at the flow that's been prescribed by an author or an editorial team at Pearson or McGraw-Hill, and they build a course around what's available to them in the book. All of this makes good sense. The book is very durable. It's generally inexpensive, save for most textbooks. You can put a book up on a shelf for 100 years, and when you come back to it, it'll do exactly what it was supposed to do 100 years prior. You don't get a blue screen of death or forget your password with a book. But the book has a ton of fundamental limitations. It's static, it can't respond to the user, and it constrains a learner to a very specific style of learning that dates back quite a while. This is the anatomy lecture of Dr. Nicholas Tolbert's, a Rembrandt painting from 1632. And you can see that this is before the age of the textbook, but it is a bunch of males standing around. I like to say he's doing a live demo. He's got his cadaver out and doing an anatomy lecture. And this oral tradition, this method of education, has been with us since as long as people have been communicating orally. Nowadays, of course, nobody ever gets up in front of a group and just talks, right? That's just kidding. Cue the laughter. That's what I'm doing right now. Along came this little technology innovation called the printing press. And the printing press was originally used for the classics. It was used with the Gutenberg Bible. And over time, one of the fundamental prerequisites to using printed materials was met by a huge portion of Western society: literacy. People learned how to read. And when they learned how to read, they could use the book as this remarkable technology device to access knowledge without the presence of another human being. You didn't have to be at Dr. Nicholas Tulp's anatomy lecture in order to learn anatomy. You could look at a book. And this fundamentally shifted the way that human beings learned and has been the basis of the way people learn all the way through to today. That was many hundreds of years ago. And then along came this. Anybody ever use one of these?
Yeah.
A few of you? Okay, good. It was a pretty popular machine in its day. First portable computer, it had a handle on top. You know, the computer, electricity, the internet, when I look back at the printing press, it's hundreds of years ago. Hundreds of years from now, people will look back at our period in time and say, electricity and computers happened around the same time. The world prior to electricity and the world after the internet as we know it today will have been a very fine point in time. So what does this all mean? Well, the first thing it means is that we're at the very, very cusp of taking advantage of technology for learning. But when you think about the textbook as a fundamental tool in the classroom today, it's apparent that we have not made great strides in this respect. We're still using what is fundamentally the same tool that they were using 200 years ago to learn and to teach. So it begs the question, where do we go from here? What's next? What is it that we're going to use that's going to be so much better and so obviously better than a textbook that we're actually going to stop buying them? Well, for those of you who are unfamiliar, this is a textbook. Textbooks are actually really remarkable devices. They're finely honed over the course of hundreds of years to do precisely one thing, which is to help someone learn something. It's distinct from a Danielle Steele novel, which is formulated for something quite different. But books that try to assemble knowledge in print, well, there's a whole bunch of different categories of this kind of book. One of them you probably wouldn't spend money on anymore. It's the encyclopedia. The encyclopedia had traveling salespeople who used to go door to door to sell you these really expensive books. It's absurd to think that you would have a traveling sales team to sell books. And yet, when you think about the current state of the textbook industry, that's sort of where we are. The book, the textbook, is absolutely going the way of the encyclopedia. Publishers know it, we know it. The question is, why hasn't it happened yet? Well, this is a book, and it is a canvas. Just like the wall behind you with this beautiful mural is a canvas, just like a postcard is a canvas. And on that canvas, you can create anything. You can put information on it as you see fit. This is one kind of canvas with a certain set of constraints and limitations. This is a fundamentally different canvas. And if you take a book and throw it onto this canvas, you've kind of got a Frankenstein, because it doesn't take advantage of any of the capabilities of this new canvas, but is fully constrained by its limitations. Limitations like a $499 minimum price point. Limitations like if you drop it, it breaks, unlike a book. So there are a lot of ways in which throwing a book onto an iPad is absolutely the wrong approach, and it's something that we think we need to quickly leapfrog. You have to treat these two canvases as fundamentally different, and that's one of the problems that we're tackling with Inkling. There have been lots of sort of miscommunications and forays along the journey to the digital textbook, this being a bit of a hiccup, because digital devices are capable of so much more and of appealing to such a broad array of learners that to simply copy the textbook into the world of the digital would be to fundamentally miss the opportunity at hand. Lucky for us, the human brain is a really, really powerful device. It adapts, and when you put something under the nose of someone, they will find a way to make the most of it. We discovered fire, we invented the book, we invented the iPad, and there are plenty of opportunities to go beyond what we do today. Now, we learned to learn from books. Each of us, in our own way, learned how to learn from books. And there's a backhanded compliment for people who learned how to learn from books, but aren't necessarily good at anything else. Anybody know what that backhanded compliment is? Oh, he did well on his exam? Well, he's just book smart. Book smart is a way to describe somebody who learned how to learn from books really well, but didn't necessarily learn how to be a salesperson or learn how to make friends. Book smart is a difficult word, and I think that when we rearrange the notion of learning content altogether, you can get to a point where the term book smart isn't needed anymore. We don't also need the other term for someone who didn't do so well on their exams but is a great salesperson. Street smart. There's a word for people who are both book smart and street smart. It's smart. We don't necessarily use this as a brand word, but we believe in the concept of a smart book. And a smart book has three big characteristics in my mind. First, a smart book is interactive. It means that when you touch it, it responds to you. It somehow provides an experience to you based on what you're doing with it. Second, it's dynamic. It means that if you're somebody who enjoys viewing video, listening to audio, exploring rich primary information in your history course, that for you, the experience is you. And for someone who really enjoys the prose of a well-written novel inside of a history book, then for you, that experience is you. Dynamism in the learning experience, we know personalization is absolutely core to preserving engagement in learning, and engagement is what ultimately reduces dropout rates and increases performance. And finally, everything we do as human beings is social, except for sitting in a library staring at a book. It's a horribly isolating experience to read a textbook. Why not have your community, your professor, your students, all of the learning resources and people in your learning community at your disposal, right inside your learning content? So these are the things that we aspire to with Inkling, and I want to show you really quickly what Inkling looks like on an iPad. So when you open up Inkling, you're brought to a menu of all the content that you have available to you in your library. And I'm going to show you just a few quick titles to illustrate what's possible, not tomorrow or next year or, you know, 10 years from now, but what students have access to today. I'll show you first a science title. This is a best-selling biology title from McGraw-Hill. And when you come into Inkling, you have this scrolling column of all the content available to you in that title on the left-hand side. And then when you choose a title, or a chapter rather, it shows you a summary of all of the information available to you in that chapter on the right. Now, we don't use pages in Inkling because it's not a book. So when I come into a card, everything about blood and blood components in this case is right here in this one scrolling column. Whenever there's a term that needs to be defined, I can tap on it and instantly get a definition straight from the glossary. And when I see an image that I want to drill down on, I can simply tap that image and zoom in and see a nice high-resolution piece of artwork. Now, in this case, the student is learning about how oxygen bonds to the iron atom at the center of this lattice structure. And that's a useful way to look at it. But I can also simply render out heme in 3D. So when I tap, now I have a beautiful 3D rendering of the heme molecule, which I can spin and zoom and explore to understand the relationship between structure and function. Now, I can jump out to a different biology textbook, Campbell Biology. This is the number one selling textbook, I think, ever. in any subject matter on Earth. And if I jump into concept 6.3, in this case studying the cell, you can see that I can now visually drill down into information. So here I've got the cell and the nucleus. If I tap on the nucleus, it zooms up and shows me a diagram. I can come down and see the nuclear pore. And if I want, I can even zoom down and see an electron micrograph of the surface of that object. And I can see that this is actually a complex hierarchy of images that I can freely explore just by tapping. For a student who has to learn the labels, they can tap this button in the top left corner, strip off the labels, and come in and quiz themselves. When we put this in front of students, they're instantly engrossed in the content and excited at the opportunity to learn this way, rather than simply staring at it on a piece of paper. Now, I'm going to skip to something a little bit different. Here is a history book. This is American history. And I'm going to skip to chapter 23 on the United States and the Cold War. And you can see as I scroll that there's tons of media available to the student here. If I come down to the section on the anti-communist crusade, I can scroll through and I see a high-resolution image that I can tap and zoom here. People are getting irradiated by a nuclear bomb. They just don't know it yet. It's actually really depressing when you read this chapter about the stuff that the US government conducted during the 1940s and 50s. This book actually is so engaging that we had a reading club within the company, and we did a chapter for everybody, and it turns out that half the company ended up reading about half of this entire history book, which was a nice data point for a bunch of folks that are actually engineers. We actually taught them something other than computers for once. If I jump over into these bookmarks on the side, these are bookmarks that I can share with my friends or with my professor. If I want to listen to Winston Churchill's speech, I can simply hit listen now, and it instantly begins to play Winston Churchill. About the present position in Europe. The media that we can bake into these titles is really remarkable. Music appreciation titles have staff notation that the student can follow along with. The history books always have video and audio of firsthand accounts of all of these events. And you can see even coming into the prior presenter was talking a little bit about exploring America through its constitution. I'm not going to go out into the constitutional section of this title, but you'll see that all of this primary media, being able to come in and actually see acts of Congress with the live signatures on those documents, brings history to life in a way that a textbook never could. History, biology, music, you name it, all of these titles are in the process of being built for Inkling, and in a way that doesn't just replicate the book experience, but really brings it to life in a way that the physical book never could. So I'd love to sit here and bludgeon you with demos for 30 minutes, because it's pretty compelling stuff, but I hope that gives you a sense of the sort of work that we're doing. So where are we today as a company, and what does this look like in terms of classroom use? Inkling today is actively in use at a little over 60 institutions, having launched the product just a year ago. So we're looking forward to a very exciting 2012 and 2013 as our library expands and as institutions become aware of these possibilities. You know, there's a few interesting things about what attracts people to Inkling, one being that everything in Inkling is certainly a lot cheaper than the print book. It's usually 30 to 40% cheaper than buying a new print book. But more importantly, everything in Inkling is available by the chapter. What that means is if a professor assigns 15 out of the 60 chapters that you saw in that biology textbook, at $2.99 a chapter, the student pays $45 over the course of the entire semester, rather than paying $200 in September. And this modularity in the content structure is just step one of many, many steps that we seek to implement in putting control over who spends what when back into the hands of the professor and the student, rather than having it be according to this sort of traditional adoption model where billions of dollars are spent every year on things that people ostensibly do not want. So my recommendations to you as you think about how to capture this opportunity in time. Number one, we think that when faculty begin to think beyond the textbook and start looking at digital media as a core asset in the learning process, that we're going to have the leverage with publishers to design programs that are more flexible and cost effective. Number two, you guys have millions and millions of students in your system. You have leverage. You have so much more leverage than me and my 80 employees in downtown San Francisco. What you decide to do with the dollars that you have is going to influence the way that these products are developed and the way that the big power brokers in this industry respond to folks like us. Number three, pilot things. Pilot, pilot, pilot. The more you get these sorts of technologies into the hands of faculty and students, the more people's eyes are going to be open to the opportunity. And we're committed to working with you and any institution in the state that wants to work with us to implement even small-scale programs to show that there's a future for this kind of learning technology. And finally, when you make technology a key component of your strategy for growing the system over the course of the next, you know, 3-5 years, use that technology to gain economies of scale in your cost structure that allows you to phase out some of these antiquated, you know, expensive print materials from the entire program. Because you might have to spend $500 up front for an iPad as a student, but if it's saving you $1,000 over the course of 2 years, there's real benefit there. As I said, we're not totally iPad. We're doing iPads today, but anybody with a web browser will be able to access this technology in the first half of next year, and certainly before the back-to-school season in 2012. I'm sure you're all avid Twitter users, and if you are, I heard somebody, was it Vice President Perez in the audience saying something about Twitter? If you are on Twitter and you want to sort of keep up to date on what we're doing, that's our handle, and we tweet regularly about what we're developing. So thank you so much for all of the work that you guys do for the state. I'm happy to answer any questions that I can.
Yeah. Board members? Vice President Perez.
What a great app. I'm actually downloading it as you speak.
Good.
But I mean, I love it because it's innovative, and more importantly, I love the point that you made about students can actually access chapter by chapter. I just remember so oftentimes buying books and only reading a select few of chapters, right. But then I had this huge book, and when I returned it to the bookstore, I don't think I got nearly my return on that investment.
There's definitely a disconnect between what people expect to be paid for a secondhand book and what
exactly.
they get.
Exactly. Yeah. But how are books made available on this? Is it up to the authors? Is it up to the book manufacturers? I mean, how do you have access to these books to actually be available here?
Right, so we work with all of the major publishers in the US to bring their content to the platform. Part of these titles are produced in downtown San Francisco, where we disassemble them and then reassemble them for iPad with all of the media that's available to us. And other times we sort of automate the process. It depends on the title. But we do source the material today from the major publishers. That too will be something that broadens over time. We're looking forward to actually allowing faculty to bring their own content and resources to the platform as a distribution mechanism directly to their students.
That was my second question. How receptive has faculty been to utilizing this?
This is the sort of thing where I can do I can spend $1 million on cool web materials and stuff, and yeah, faculty can spend an hour with that and not really appreciate the potential. But if I can spend 5 minutes with a faculty member and show it to them firsthand, it's night and day. So for us, when a faculty member sees what we have, it's love at first sight. They understand the potential with their students. I didn't show you guys the capacity of the platform for the faculty member to communicate directly with his or her students inside the title. But when students annotate and comment and have conversations in the content, faculty can then respond, and likewise, students can communicate with one another inside the content. So it brings a whole new level of value. Seton Hill, a small college on the East Coast, mandates that students come in and communicate, and the professors leave breadcrumb trails of interesting information inside the book for their students. You bet your top dollar those students are in there every Sunday night making sure that they see what the prof had to say. We work pretty closely with all the faculty who are sort of early adopters, although today now there's a pretty good support network faculty to faculty for getting to know how to use the platform.
Member McDougall.
You may have answered the first question I had by your response, but I was wondering if you work at all with campus bookstores, just from the standpoint of an interface, an infrastructure that exists on the campus. You can only visit the campus so often, et cetera. But once faculty get exposed to it and get some understanding, is there any relationship that you might have with bookstores? That's question number one, and whether you see that as a bad road to go down or whatever, I'd be interested in your thought. Question number two is, I noticed you had a community college on that list of institutions, Broward Community College. I'd be particularly interested in any evaluative material you might have gotten back from them about how they felt it worked. And then the third and final question is, your technology, at this point at least, limited only to textbooks and delivering of instruction? Do you have, for example, anything in the student services area that allows a student to engage in academic self-planning and things such as that that would be helpful, or is it strictly textbook?
Those.
So we have bookstores, Broward, and student services. So bookstores. We do engage with bookstores today. There are tricky waters to navigate in higher education, as I'm sure you know, with respect to kickbacks that publishers and, yeah, and operators of private bookstores give to institutions. And sometimes that, you know, becomes a problem for us because there's a, say, an exclusive contract between a bookstore operator and a campus for the distribution of textbooks. And then we just say, well, we're not a textbook, but, you know, you can debate that until you're blue in the face. The short answer is yes, we work with bookstores. The long answer has a lot to do with the future of the distribution of this content and whether this goes through the IT department or the, yeah, bookstore and yada, yada, yada. But we keep an open mind with respect to that piece of it today. With respect to the community college, I'm not familiar with their use case specifically. I can speak to one case that is at least peripherally related, which is our first actual results-focused study. The Virginia Department of Education deployed Inkling into the hands of senior year AP students and gave half of the students an iPad with Inkling and half of the students the print copy of the related title. Both cohorts improved their AP scores year over year from the prior cohort, but the Inkling students improved 50% more than the students with the print book. So that's encouraging. Other data points around user satisfaction are encouraging, but we intend to spend a few years doing something a lot more rigorous and with proper controls to see how this affects learning outcomes. With respect to student services, today we really do consider ourselves to be a publishing platform, although I didn't show you all of the assessment tools that are built into the platform. So students come in, when they get something wrong, they're given feedback specific to that incorrect response. They're given data about how they've been performing themselves, and next year they'll be given data relative to their cohort, so they'll know where they stand with globally the users of the book, as well as people around them that they know on Facebook, et cetera, et cetera. So give them sort of self-evaluation data, but that's purely academic, not so much student services in perhaps the context that you raised the question.
Is there any plan to go into, or are you gonna stay right in the textbook area?
You know, I don't know. Okay. And I'd probably need to better understand the scope of student services as you've defined it.
Member Malumed, then Member Baum.
I think you're in Turkey. Do you know? Because I went to a science high school, and they were using a product exactly like this. And it was a big old wow. The professor was at the front of the room, and he had all these tools. And he could move things and expand things. And it was very impressive. So I'm glad to hear that it's here.
I didn't know what I think you're in Turkey meant. And I thought I was
about
to get a tongue lashing.
Serious. No, the country of Turkey. I was there a year ago.
Oh, you think we're in Turkey?
Yes.
Turkey. The
they have
okay.
They gather up their best students in science and math and put them in a high school where they live, and we toured it and they had things like this. So I suspect you are.
We do. It's really interesting. We do about and I don't how public is this forum?
Very.
Very.
It's
okay.
Livecast.
We do a very substantial portion of our revenue internationally, and that's been a big surprise to us. Australia. The Middle East, actually one Middle Eastern country was yesterday the third largest country to transact with us. So it's very interesting to see how these technologies are being used abroad. And there was a really interesting, Fareed Zakaria did a very interesting study on the state of American education last night on CNN and talked
about
how American schools versus international schools. So, I mean, I worked for Apple in China for 2.5 years and sat in the back of a lot of Chinese classrooms, and I can tell you it's no utopia there either. But with respect to technology adoption, they have been much more aggressive, and that's been an interesting point for us, just from a business perspective, to see how Turkey, whether it be the clucking turkey that I thought I was a second ago, or the country, seems to have the leg up.
And I remember having a bit of a sinking feeling, because I was like, oh my gosh, look how great this is. So I'm hopeful you'll go everywhere.
Thank you.
It was a wonderful thing.
Yeah. Last comment, Member Baum.
Just thanks for a great presentation, and it's a related comment, not directly related to education, but you plan to roll this out also with partners in other forms of publishing, whether it's trade, newspapers, magazines, because those are industries that are suffering right now.
Right. So newspapers and magazines. So actually, if you think about Inkling on the spectrum of the shelf life of a given publication, from a blog to a tweet, which is the shortest lived publication, to a newspaper, which is about a day long, to a magazine, which can be a weekly or a monthly magazine. And then you get into annuals and out into titles that sit on the shelf for years. Now, textbooks used to sit on the shelves, you know, be viable work products for 5 years. Now they're viable work products for 2 years, not because we need to update Einstein's theory, but because we need to rearrange the page numbers or, you know, update. Sometimes it's legitimate, so I shouldn't say terrible things, but other times it's more of an economic interest. For us, we're focused on a platform that supports content that deserves the treatment required of content that has a long shelf life. So the short answer to your question is, you know, we have a really cool cocktails book on the platform. If you want to make a Manhattan, you'll still be making Manhattans 50 years from now. And so trade is an interesting area for us, but honestly, our core focus is on reinventing learning content in an institutional context. And so you'll see that product features and content direction will really focus on making the life of the faculty member not just easier, but making the faculty member more effective as an educator in the classroom.
Yeah. Second last word, Member Davidson.
Thank you for being here. This is extremely exciting. And the piece that I want to know more about, and maybe you can send me where it is on your site, is I want to see that research. You know, you mentioned one, but I really would like to see that. So
I'll send you more than
send?
Just that. I'll send you sort of a compilation of, and if you want, President Himmelstein, I can send to you, and maybe you can distribute to the board.
That would
get
be
it out.
Great.
Some literature on this topic. I mean,
sure.
As I said earlier, it's early days. Where the product is a little over a year old, so there's plenty to learn, but we'll show you that the early returns are positive. Okay?
Okay, Matt, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Very good presentation. Yeah, I just thought, you know what, this is something. And interest of full disclosure, I have no investments, no tie to Inkling whatsoever. I literally just read about this in a magazine. I said, this sounds great.
Yeah.
So I wanted to expose all of us to it. And I would ask, Matt, since there does seem to be some interest here, that keep us in the loop on how you're doing. I think we'd be particularly interested if there are any things on the docket are going to happen with community colleges here or elsewhere.
And I think on the flip side, what we'd like to do is make sure that if there are, either in this room or in the sites that are simulcast, parties who are interested in working with us, you know, even in an academic context, we do get to measure results. For us, those early established beachheads within the institutions is critical. So we're eager to partner and work with the system.
Great.
Thanks.
Thank you. Okay.
We have one public comment.
We actually have one public comment on this, I guess. Okay.
So Kevin Feliciano, Student Senate, California Community Colleges.
So continuing on with my trend of making comments on things, this is exciting. I think it's great, and it's definitely one of those resources that students could definitely buy into. You know, there are, like I said, it's one of many resources. We do have stuff like OER and open source textbooks and stuff like that. Anything to keep the cost down for students, I think, is great. For me, I'm a very visual learner, so the fact that I could tap on things and it'll take me somewhere else is great. You know, though I may not support particular platforms or whatever, I think anything that we can do as a system to help introduce technology to help improve student success by way of if a student doesn't have to spend as much money on a textbook, they can spend that money on, you know, housing or food, the better. Thank you.
Thank you.